we sing? We're going to sing. It's a mystery. We are going to sing. We have come into his house. Say it as we sing. Oh, I just want to say that.
What a wonderful crowd for a Sunday rainy night. I tell you what, there's no better place to be anyway than right here in the Lord's house tonight. And we're just so glad you're here. And we're just so glad that you're able to just come back and to worship with us. And we're just looking forward to what God's going to do tonight in this second service of what we're calling our one-day revival. And you know it's not going to just stop tonight. Chip and I were talking this morning, and you know if God says let's keep it going, we'll do what God says. And you know that's what we got to pray for, that God would just set a fire in our hearts that we could just go and just continue this on and just do what he wants to. What better time to have a revival season than a revival in our hearts and our churches than right here in our Thanksgiving season, leading up to the birth of our Lord and our celebration of that. And so let's just pray that God would just keep the revival fires going. And we just thank you for being here. We know we got a few visitors, and thank you all for coming. We really appreciate that. And we just want to say welcome, and you're always welcome here. We're honored when we have guests. A few announcements before we move on to our services. Just remember, Thursday night we'll have the Down East Boys here with us at 7 o'clock. We're looking forward to a great time. And just be here and know that that's going to be a great time in fellowship for us. So just be praying about that. And if anybody can come and help us out, we'd greatly appreciate it. So just be here about 4 o'clock. Anybody can help us unload. And then if you can't come, then come about 5:15 to help us park and be ushers and all that. And then women, remember Friday night, your baked potato salad bar and your craft time together. If you hadn't signed up, the sign-up sheet's right over here. If you have any questions, see Connie or Miss Janice about that.
If you signed up to come, please bring scissors.
Okay.
Sewing scissors or regular scissors?
Scissors.
Oh, we're cutting cloth.
You're cutting cloth, so bring something sharp, okay? Sharp scissors. Well, and just remember, hey, isn't this a great sight right here? Now, these are all filled boxes ready to be mailed off, and our youth work this afternoon, and some have already brought it. Isn't that a great sight? Randall, what you got to help me there? Tell me what we got.
85 total packs right there.
Remember, if you're doing them at home, bring them next Sunday morning so we can get them to the proper locations the following week, and we'll be doing that. But wow, what a joy it is. We're going to just leave these here, even for the concert Thursday night. I think it'll work. That way they'll be here. So you be bringing yours, and we'll add those to our collection there. Thank y'all so much for that. That's all the announcements I have. Is there anything else before we go to our prayer time? Remember our business meeting next Sunday night. Our deacons and trustees have an item of business that they need to present in a special call business meeting, and that'll be done next Sunday evening before we get started in our service. So if you would just remember that and be praying about that. If not, we do want to go to our prayer time and remember those that have been mentioned this morning. Remember Miss Betty Malone, that's Patsy's mother who was taken to the hospital. She was admitted today with pneumonia. So be praying for, we call her Mama, and just remember her in these times and just remember them. Also, David Hendricks will be having his procedure this week. So just to be praying for him and his wife and many others. And I think Dwight had to go home, not feeling well, just feeling tired. Remember Dwight, what a great joy it was just to see him playing the guitar this morning, being here, to just pray for him today and this week. And again, pray for Rebecca. She'll be going for her last treatment this week, and just ringing that bell and just pray for her as that's going. And continue to pray for Mr. Shipman, who was here this morning. Just pray for him as he'll be having a treatment also in 2 weeks. He'll have another one. So continue to pray for him also. How about this is a time we always open up for others. Is there others that we need to just mention before we go to our Lord in prayer? Quiet bunch tonight. Yeah, let's continue to remember Tiffany. Miss Tiffany had surgery this week and is recovering at home, so let's continue to remember Tiffany in our prayers. And how about others?
Patsy Bradbury.
Patsy, Miss Patsy, let's remember her. Sure thing. Thank you, David. Any others? Thank you, Miss Connie. That's right. Our country, and just, you know, we all were praying, and however God answered the prayers, and your opinion was good, but I think God's will is being done, and he's given us as Christians an opportunity to stand firm, because we're going to probably have more freedoms than we think that we could have had, and we're going to be able to just spread the gospel. So it's going to be our responsibility now to stand up and to voice our opinions and just tell others about Jesus Christ. So, oh wow, well let's pray that God would do his will in that. Thank you. Thank you so much for that. Anybody else before we go to our Lord in prayer? Let's pray for Riley. What day is that?
Wednesday.
Let's remember Riley on Wednesday. And if you would, just remember our state Baptist convention. Our South Carolina Baptist convention opens up tomorrow in Columbia. Randall and I know Chip said he was going, and we're riding with some friends. We're going down for the pastor's conference in the morning, be there all day tomorrow, and the conference is all week. So be praying for our state convention as we'll be passing some things there and just doing things that will kind of help us carry the word out to many, many others. So just hope you'll make that a matter of prayer also. Anything else before we go to the Lord in prayer? Well, let's pray, and then we'll continue our worship and song. Father, we thank you so much for tonight. We thank you for this number of people that come out on a rainy Sunday night. Lord, it's not by chance that any one of us are here. We know, Father God, that you have us here for a reason and a purpose, and that's to hear your word, to hear you speak, and to hear you talk to each and every one of us. Lord, we thank you for your servant, Chip, who has given his day today to come and to share two messages with us that you've laid upon his heart. And Father God, we pray that you would just bless him and his wife as they continue their ministry there at Pacolet Baptist Church. We just pray that you just be near and dear to that family there and to them and their ministry. And Lord, we pray for all these that have been mentioned tonight. There's many for the David Hendricks and his wife. We continue to lift them up. We do pray for Betty Malone. We pray that you just be with her and help her as she's recovering. Continue to be with Miss Tiffany. We pray as she's recovering from this surgery. Lord, we do ask that you would just, be with Riley as she has some tests on Wednesday, and just pray you'll watch over her. And Father God, we pray in a special way that you would just touch Dwight's body tonight as he's tired and weak and, Lord, feeling nauseous. We just pray that you would take care of him. And Lord, we continue to lift up Mr. Charles, and we pray for Rebecca, and we just thank you that she's getting to finish up her treatment on Thursday. And Lord God, we pray for many others that need our prayers. I know there's a lot of unspoken requests this morning, and those requests are still there. But Lord, we come tonight now just asking that you would do a work within our hearts. Father, we do pray for revival, and Lord, we pray that you would just send it down tonight. And Lord, as we heard this morning of not wanting second best, but Father, we want what you want for us, which is the best. And Father God, we pray that each and every one of us tonight would just search our hearts. And if there's anything that could hinder revival coming down into this church tonight, I pray, Father, that we would stand up and repent right away. Father, we pray if there's anyone here tonight that doesn't know Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, that they would just, Lord, just surrender to him tonight. And Lord, just follow him and accept him as their Savior. Father, we do ask your blessings upon this time. We pray you'll be with all the ones that will come to share. And we just pray, Father God, that your will be done. And we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Stand as, again as we sing, I Saw the Light. Stand as we sing.
I saw the light, no more. Well, I know we kind of changed up just a little bit tonight, and, well, we need change every now and again, right? Well, I changed up, and that ain't a good thing when I change up. I had picked out what I was going to try to share in the song tonight, and all of a sudden, just up there in the choir loft, just minding my own business, trying to sing, and, well, it was kind of a 180. But it come about when you was sharing, you know, about the fact that a lot of our prayers were answered this week in the election. And it's not so much that who's right and who's wrong, it's just whose values, whose morals kind of lines up a little bit better with mine and with yours. And so I said, well, you know, and I'd done already, through Randall's lesson this morning, I'd done already picked out kind of what I was going to try to share next week in Sunday school. And I don't know, you know, my old mind's about this big, and what usually goes in here just comes right on out the other side there. But anyway, long story short, and I'm not going to take no more time, but I do want to share this with you. I had come up with this little saying, if you want to call it a title of a lesson or whatever, that's fine. But, you know, a lot of times when we get what we wanted, we don't want it no more. And I don't mean that in a bad way. Think of it, kids, Christmas is coming. You got something you want. You've got it on your list. Well, when you get it, you don't really want it anymore. You'll take it, and you're going to have fun with it right now, but you don't want that specific thing anymore. Well, can I just tell you tonight, we may feel like our person won the election, but we still can't forget to pray, and we still can't forget to pray for him, and we can't forget to pray for our leaders on a local level, state level, national level. It doesn't matter. But I knew that Brother Chip was going to be sharing some racing stuff tonight, and I guess just my mind started whirling, and I said, well, I'm going to share a song that's a little untraditional tonight, or non-traditional, however you want to say it. If my voice will let me, you know, you come up with a coughing fit about the time you're going to share. But y'all help me out on this one. Y'all recognize it. If tomorrow all the things were gone, I'd worked for all my life, and I had to start again with just my children and my wife. I thank my God above to be living here today, 'cause the flag still stands for freedom, and they can't take that away. And I'm proud to be an American, where at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the men who died, who gave that right to me. And I gladly stand up next to you and defend her still today, 'cause there ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the USA. From the lakes of Minnesota to the hills of Tennessee, across the plains of Texas, from sea to shining sea, from Detroit down to Houston, from New York to L.A., well, there's pride in every American heart, and it's time we stand and say, that I'm proud to be an American, where at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the men who died, who gave that right to me. And I gladly stand up next to you and defend her still today, 'cause there ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the USA. And I'm proud to be an American, where at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the men who died, who gave that right to me. And I gladly stand up next to you and defend her still today. 'Cause there ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the USA.
Before we do our prayer song, I'm gonna go ahead and introduce our preacher tonight. But, you know, with Tommy singing that and with all the things, and just being able to sit in a building tonight, we just need to give God the glory. There's a lot of people in this world today that would give anything to be sitting in a nice, dry, warm, cool, air-conditioned building that can't do this. And we take it for granted so often. Tommy, thank you for that. And I tell you, Chip, I feel led to do this before we introduce you. I want everybody to just bow your heads tonight. Father, we feel your presence here right now. Lord, in this preacher's heart right now, I'm just coming to you. And Lord, if there's anything that's standing in between me and you, Lord, reveal it to me now and let me just turn and repent from it and ask for forgiveness. Lord, I pray that everyone sitting in this building right now will just pause. And Lord, you'll speak to us all. And Lord, if there's anything that would hinder revival from coming down, Lord, would you just remove it? We bind Satan from this building. We bind him from this place. We ask your anointing upon your preacher for tonight. And Lord God, we just know that you're going to do a mighty work here. In Jesus' name. Well, as I introduced him this morning, Chip Coleman, who is a dear friend of mine, like I said, a mentor. I've relied upon him many times, and chaplain of, like he said this morning, Broome High School. Matter of fact, I think we decided about this meeting on the 50-yard line at the beginning of the football season, didn't we? We were both standing out there and just talking and said we'd pray about it, and we started praying about it, and God kind of brought this about after the football game and over the next few weeks. But Chip and his wife, Rochelle, live up in Packlet and just dear friends. And just, I tell you, I can't say enough about him. But I just thank God for men like Chip that will preach the word. And I know he will, even in some difficult circumstances. And a man that has poured his life into people like myself and other guys. And when he teaches at Covington, guys, I just want you to know, he doesn't take any pay. He does that so we will have a place to go and to be able to learn. And there's been hundreds of us that have gone through Covington Theological Seminary because of men like Chip that they have poured their lives in. And it's ever so grateful, and I'm so thankful. And I just want to say, Chip, thank you. In a moment after our prayer song, you come and you just do and go where God leads you tonight. And we're just looking forward and just can't say enough. Thank you for giving up your Sunday at your church to come and just bless us here this morning.
Thank you. feel a little bit like a pastor that died a few years ago in West Columbia. His name was Bob Kelly. Anybody know Bob Kelly? Bob Kelly gained the name Machine Gun Bob Kelly. And the reason being is when it was time to finish the song and preach, or he was introduced, whatever, when Bob Kelly stood up from his seat, he began to preach. And I'm thinking, that's what I'm going to do tonight. Amen? I'm ready to go. So thank you, Brother Dwayne, for inviting us to be here and for the wonderful meal and the place to stay. And thank you to every person who has spoken kind words to my wife and I. And we are thankful to be here. We are very grateful. Grateful for guests that are with us, and just thankful for the normal church folks that are here week in and week out. And I pray that God will continue to bless Asaville Baptist Church. Tonight I'm not here to entertain you, not at all. Tonight I come with a heavy burden to preach God's word and to illustrate it. I want you to go with me to Hebrews chapter 12. Hebrews chapter 12. Now this morning we were in Hebrews chapter 9 and we saw that God has given us the wonderful blessing. If we know Christ as Lord and Savior, we are blessed to live aware of His presence all of our life. We don't have to continually go back and get saved over and over again, because when He saves us, He saves us once for all. When He died on the cross, He died on the cross once for all. And rather than having to run back and to worry and think and constantly go to a temple or a church building, though we should be in church, we get to live in the presence of the Lord all the time. Tonight we're going to look at Hebrews chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. And I want to remind you that in the New Testament, and even in the Old Testament, but especially in the New Testament, God used the Apostle Paul to illustrate the Christian life. One time the Apostle Paul used the illustration of a runner, somebody who's trying to win a race, to win the crown. Another time he spoke of a boxer, and he referred to the spiritual aspect that our faith is grounded in reality, and ministry is grounded in effectiveness when it is done honest in the power of the Holy Spirit with the Word of God. And he says, it's not like we are boxing thin air. We do not see stock car racing in the Bible. I want you to know that. In case you think that somehow it's there, it's not. But I will tell you that whenever you look in the Bible, you see racing. And I thought of this one time. I thought about how we see chariot races in history on tops of walls. They said that the city of Jericho in the book of Joshua was actually so wide that there were homes built on that wall and in that wall, and that they used to have chariot races around the top of that wall. All I know is this: the salvation that God gives us, that we have been given through Jesus Christ, if we have repented and turned from our sin and believed on Christ, that salvation is so glorious, so wonderful, that God wants to give various illustrations throughout His Word that would capture our attention and cause us to pay attention to the details of the Christian experience. I want to take it a step further. God's salvation is so wonderful that He does not save us and then leave us alone. Some folks act as though God saves you and says, hey, listen, you do the best you can, I'll come get you later. That's not how salvation works. When God saves your soul, He regenerates you. He gives you a new nature. He gives you new desires. He gives you new purpose. And He doesn't leave you to yourself. He literally births you into His family known as the church. And as a believer, until Jesus comes back, it is essential that every believer be active and functioning in a local church, because that's God's design for every believer. And so as we live out the Christian life, the Bible gives us the illustration of running a race and running it well. And tonight, with the help of the Lord, I want to illustrate the race that the Christian runs and some illustrations that are involved in stock car racing that are very relevant to Hebrews chapter 12. Listen as I read. Therefore, we also, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily ensnares us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Pray with me. Father, we come before you in the name of Jesus, asking that you not allow these racing flags to be a distraction, but to be a tool that would draw us to the reality of what you have told us in your word. May we leave this place tonight convicted, confronted, comforted, challenged, and may we leave here with a holy determination to enjoy the blessedness of salvation and to run the race that you have chosen for us and to do it well. I pray this in Jesus' name for his sake. Amen. Excuse me. We may need to cough a verse of amazing grace or something before it's over with tonight. As I said a while ago, God has prepared for every believer a race to run. I bring the checkered flag out first because I want you to think just for a moment. Y'all forgive me. What are you spraying in your throat? 90 proof or something like that. I'm just joking. I'm very serious. I'm joking. All right. Oh, me. But anyway, we have a race to run. You think about what happened this afternoon. If you notice on television, NASCAR, I believe it was their championship race run in Phoenix today. I was blessed to be involved in stock car racing for about 8 years. I still go every now and then. I worked a race this year. And I started out as a chaplain. This may shock Justin and Ron, but my first year, I would come home from races at Anderson Motor Speedway, and Rochelle would ask me, my wife, she would ask me, how did it go? And I would say, Rochelle, it didn't go well. Very few people would talk to me. Well, I was new. I was new, and I just needed to build some relationships. And I'm glad I didn't quit, because over the next 7 years, including that year, God allowed me to be a chaplain in stock car racing, which I grew up 3 miles from Birmingham International Raceway. And all of the race fans know that the Alabama gang raced there. I grew up watching Donnie come sometimes and Bobby sometimes, but I watched Davey Allison start in the old limited sportsman division, basically had a Chevelle with wide tires on it. I saw Clifford race. I saw, you know, many of the racers. Bobby Allison passed away yesterday. I grew up in that atmosphere. I had men in our church that we attended that owned cars, and some of them raced. And even today, some of my friends there in Alabama that I grew up watching race, they still own cars and do some racing. So I grew up in that atmosphere, and as I got into being a race chaplain and then an official, you know, actually doing official work, I saw all of the similarities between the Christian walk and stock car racing. lot of these similarities are seen in all types of races. I want you to look in the text with me, because we don't want to learn about the purpose of flags tonight. We want to learn what God has to say to us about this incredible race that He wants to allow us to enjoy the checkered flag, so to say. I want you to notice with me there in verse number 1, it says, therefore we also. The idea in verse number 1 that we need to understand is that as the writer of Hebrews has encouraged Christians to enjoy the best things in life through Jesus, as he has warned them, don't go back, but go forward, move forward, enjoy all that God has prepared for you. Don't let people pull you back away from the truth of who Jesus is. He says, we also, makes that statement. Who is he talking about? Why, if you go to a stock car race, you're going to have a group of people in the infield. You're going to have drivers, crew members. You're going to have some spectators, emergency personnel, police officers, chaplains. You're going to have people in the infield. But at the racetrack, you're also going to have a set of grandstands. And there's going to be people in those grandstands. Now, I want you to know something. Those people in those grandstands are not what is being pictured right here in Hebrews chapter 12. The we also conveys the idea that there's someone else that has been involved in a race that God gave them, and we can come along and we can learn from them. So when he says, we also, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let me say this, this great cloud of witnesses, not only is it not representing the people sitting in the grandstands, it's also not representing our loved ones that are in heaven necessarily. A lot of people get confused and they'll read the Bible, because whenever someone dies, we like to get sentimental and we like to try to soften the blow of someone passing. In fact, I just read an article this week about the difference between having a celebration of life and a funeral. Nobody wants to have a funeral anymore. They want to have a celebration of life. And the reason why they don't want to have a funeral is because that sounds morbid. And it makes you face the fact that someone has died. Hello, neighbor, I want to warn you. There ain't nobody in here getting out of here alive unless you go up in the rapture. Your body's going to stop functioning one day. And your soul is going to depart your body, and it's going to go to either heaven or go to hell. It is a reality. And the article is saying, hey, listen, let's quit trying to soften everything. A funeral is a wonderful time to help people realize the reality. You're going somewhere whenever you die here. Which direction you going, up or down? And the only way to go up and enjoy the rest of it is through the Lord Jesus Christ. So anyway, this great cloud of witnesses, it's not our loved ones in heaven that are leaning over heaven watching us somehow. My dad's been in heaven since 2003. I want you to know that if my dad's been watching from the portals of glory since 2003, his heart is broken. And my dad has wept many a tear, because what he would have seen here on this earth is very heart-wrenching. It is not great, grand, and glorious all the time. And I'm telling you, I believe with all my heart, my dad is doing today what he was doing the day he departed in 2003. I believe he's worshiping the Lord right now. So just because we think of a great cloud of witnesses as our loved ones, that's not the application. That's not the context. The context is this. You go back to chapter number 10, and at the very end of chapter number 10, you will find that the writer says, we do not shrink back. We could say in modern terminology, Alabamian terminology, I'll say it, and I would say South Carolinian too, we ain't chicken hearted. As you might say here in this area, we ain't scared. We're not backing up. And so the writer says there are people that did not back up in the face of adversity. Christians, believers, followers of Christ, followers of God who did not back up. And then you go into chapter 11, and in chapter 11 you see people who did not back up. And that is the group of witnesses that chapter 12 is talking about. You see Moses and Abraham and Jacob and Isaac. They're not perfect people. They're not perfect by any stretch of the imagination, but the Word of God is giving them to us as a great cloud of witnesses that you can, as a believer, enjoy and run the race that God has prepared for you, and you can take the checkered flag as a believer. There are a lot of people today that are terrified that somehow they're just going to fail God. And so rather than taking a step of faith and believing the Lord and surrendering their all to the Lord and being willing to do whatever the Lord calls them to do, they run around terrified, thinking that they might somehow fail, so they never start. I want you to know, if you're a child of God, God has called you into the race. He has put you as an entry in the race, and it is time for you to begin your race and do it quickly. And there are a host of witnesses in the book of Hebrews chapter 11, and it would involve some of our loved ones that have gone before. And there are a host of witnesses that are people that we look to and we see that they ran their race the way they should run it. They ran their race and they completed it. They followed through. Or maybe they started their race and struggled for a while, but they got it right and they got going again. And so they are an example of how you and I should run our race spiritually. God did not save us to sit, soak, and sour. God saved us to serve. God saved us to serve. In the text it says we have a great cloud of witnesses. And so then notice the next phrase. Notice what it says. Let us lay aside every weight and the sin which doth so easily ensnare us, and let us run. He says, listen, get busy about it. Get out there and go. Fulfill the mission that God has given you. Get busy serving the Lord. Now, whenever you go to a stock car race, you're going to walk in there and you're going to see a guy standing on a stand, or it can be a lady on a stand somewhere about the middle of the front straightaway, and he's going to have a set of racing flags. And he's going to be the one that is going to be directing the race as far as what you can see and somewhat as far as the drivers can see. But I want you to know something. The man on the flag stand is not the final authority. There's another man sitting in the tower, and he is a race commander. That race commander is on the radio. He's wearing a headset, and he is talking to the drivers in their car. They can't talk back to him, thank the Lord. But somebody say amen, Ron, Justin. Come on now, all right? Help me out, fellas. Help me out. He's talking to them. They can hear him in their ear, and he's talking to spotters at times and other officials. But I want you to know, he's not the end all of the race either. There's an owner of that race. There's somebody that is in charge. There is someone that has the rights to absolutely control that race. Now, I want to take your pastor and illustrate him, just use him in illustration. Let's decide that he wants to drive a race car. He goes and he says, Justin, let me borrow your hauler. Let me borrow your truck and your trailer. And he goes over to the racing store and he decides to get him a real nice fire suit. He doesn't want a plain one, white or black, you know, or anything like that. He wants to be in style. He gets him a fire suit that has flames coming up the legs and coming up the arms. He buys him a nice racing helmet, takes it over to the painter and says, listen, paint me some flames going down either side because I am going to be the faster pastor, that's for sure. He says, you know what? I saw Dale Jr. when he drove. He had those gloves that he wore on his hands, and it looked like they were bones. That was so mean and tough and intimidating. And so I want me some of those gloves. And so he says, hey, Justin, would you and Ron help me out? Ron, would you spot for me? Justin, would you be a, you know, help me? And he says, let's enter a race. And he comes up with the money, and he drives over there to the racetrack. And everybody's so excited. The faster pastor has arrived. And man, he looks sharp. He's bad to the bone with that fire suit and those gloves and that helmet. And his crew, Ron and Justin, go to the back of that car hauler. And they release the handles on it. And the tail comes down. And inside that car hauler is a John Deere 125 lawnmower. Guess what? He ain't racing. You know why? The owner said, in order to run in this race, you got to be running a 602 or a 604, whatever. You got to have this carburetor. You got to have these shocks. You got to have this roll cage. You got to have all of this equipment. May I tell you something? The race is absolutely wonderful. Oh, it's got its tough parts. It's got its tough seasons where your heart gets broken and you get wore out. And as a Christian, you run the race of life. And there are highs and lows. But overall, when it is said and done with, to be able to leave this earth and to be in the presence of the Lord and then to be able to live through the highs and lows right here and know the joys of salvation, there is nothing like it. I want you to know, in order to run that race, you have to enter the race the way that the owner says. You don't enter it by being a member. You don't enter the race by getting in the baptistry. You don't enter it by having loved ones buried in the church cemetery. You don't enter it by giving the property to the church where the church is built. You don't enter it by putting your nameplate on the end of pews. You do not enter the race that God has prepared for His people by anything you do. You enter the race because of what Jesus Christ did on the cross, that once for all sacrifice. And whenever the Holy Spirit of God opens your eyes to see that, you turn in repentance and faith, and you believe on Jesus and Jesus only, and He says you now can race the race of life. He allows you to experience the green flag. Well, in a race, there's often a yellow flag. You'll see the yellow flag in a couple of different situations. You'll see it before the race. That race commander will tell those drivers to get in their car. Officials will say, let's go, boys. And you'll see somebody say, fire them up, and they'll pull out on the track. And the flagman on the stand, he'll start waving a yellow flag. And those guys will get out there, and they'll ride around like they're on a Sunday afternoon cruise. And then all of a sudden, they'll start acting like they're drunk while they're driving. They'll start weaving back and forth. You know what's going on? That's not wasted time. They are getting ready to race, and they are getting heat in those tires. And when they start going back and forth, they start heating those tires up because those tires are not like your Michelins on your Toyota Highlander. Those tires have no tread on them, that is, in the bigger divisions. Those tires have to get hot and start to melt a little bit and get a little bit of grip to them. And so they'll go back and forth while that yellow flag is being waved. Now, during the race, you may see the yellow flag come back out, and that's because something has happened and you got to temporarily stop racing. Now you say, preacher, what does that have to do with the Christian life? Well, in the text it tells us that we are to have some preparation. Not only the way to enter the race is by obeying the command of God to believe on Christ, understanding that there are people who have gone before us, witnesses that have run their race, and they are an example to us that we can run the race that God has for us. And so there's the entry point, there's those who are witnesses, And then at the racetrack, there's a time of preparation before you get there, and actually after you're there when they start going around the track. They're preparing that race car to race. The writer here says, let us lay aside every weight. He says to us, listen, in order to win in the Christian life, in the Christian race, it's not something to be done flippantly. It is not something to be done haphazardly. I want to tell you something tonight. I'm thankful to see how that there's preparation that goes on into your services. I know that the pastor and his wife and the musicians and the choir and the sound booth, they have work that they do. And I praise God for servants who are willing to work and serve so that a church can have an organized worship service. I've been in some that were not organized and they were more like a three-ring service. But it's more than just preparing for the worship service. It is preparation for daily running your race. It is spending time with God in prayer, spending time with God dealing with the sin in your life, spending time with God making sure that your heart is ready. Now, I know that we've just come through Halloween. And at Halloween, people put on masks. And those masks are scary. And they try to have fun and scare people. But can I tell you, there's something scarier than that. It's when someone who is a child of God puts on the mask, the spiritual mask, they think, and they try to act like their life is perfect and in order. They act like nothing is wrong and that they never have to confess their sin and repent of any sin. Let me tell you, that's scarier than Halloween. Whenever someone who knows Christ is not willing to be honest. Now, you don't need to run around just airing out every temptation you express. But I'm telling you, God has called us into this race and to run this race together as a church. And we run this race and we are open and transparent with each other. And what we do is we are accountable to each other. Oh, son, I feel like preaching. Since I was here last time, Brother Dwayne, I've got a whole new perspective on this idea of people not being willing to be held accountable in the local church house. Let me tell you something, neighbor. You better hold on to your seat for a second. Don't you think for a New York second that you can bebop in this life, do whatever you want to, and nobody at the local church house ever say anything to you about how you live. Let me tell you something. God has put other believers in your life to come alongside you when you are sideways with God, put their arm around you and say, hey, listen, what's going on? Why you got this attitude? Why are you going to those places? And God has given you a pastor to stand up with the word of God, open it up, throw it in overdrive, ring the bell, and fire away in context. God has called us into a race where we are accountable. Brings me to the next flag here. When you get in that stock car race, you can't just ride around like you're on the interstate. No, you've actually got to maintain a certain pace. Sometimes you'll see a flagman have a flag like this that has a red stripe. That's becoming more and more popular, I notice. This flag right here is for those who didn't do the right amount of preparation, or maybe they had some type of failure with their car and they fall off the pace. Remember, the writer says, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which does so easily ensnare us, and let us run. The idea is there's a pace in the Christian life. And I know that not everybody is a NASCAR driver. There are some folks that drive go-karts, but you're still in the race. There are some folks that drive pony stocks or mini modifieds, but you're still in the race. Different speed, same intensity. I know that not everybody can be the pastor of the church. Not everybody can be a deacon. Not everybody can be a Sunday school teacher. But everyone who's a Christian is in the race. If you're a child of God, you're in the race. You got it. Run it at the pace you're designed and called to run it at. Driver gets out there on the track and he falls off the pace, either due to his own negligence or because of mechanical failure, and that flagman's going to see him come by if he is hindering the faster cars, and he's going to wave this flag right here, and he's going to let them know, get over. Get over. Sometimes you'll see a flagman, he'll lean over the stand, and whenever he grabs that edge and holds onto this stick and he points at you, son, you better move over. And what he's telling you is you don't have to stop running the race. You just got to get out of the way of everybody else. Son, I feel like preaching. I'm telling you right now. You know what's happened at many a Baptist church? I can tell you what's happened at many a Baptist church, Brother Duane. There's been many a Baptist church and the Holy Spirit of God, the high flagman of heaven, was saying to a child of God, hey, something's wrong, man. You got to get out of the way. You're hindering that Sunday school class. You're hindering, you know, that men's group. You're hindering that women's group. It's not that you're not running your race, but you got to get over, get out of the way so that the work of God can carry on. Let that and sit in on you for a while. Think about it. There's a pace. Are you running your pace? Or are you getting in the way? Let us lay aside every weight and which sin with us so easily set us. I'm telling you, in order to run the race, you can't do it. You can't do it with extra weight in your car. I used to joke, when I was working in the tech shed before the race, I used to joke with those crews and say, hey, y'all want me to get on your car when you go across the scales? Nobody, Ron Hall and Justin, neither one of them has ever got the rule book and it said, you got to have 3,200 pounds. And they said to themselves, boy, I think it'd be a good idea to run 3,700 pounds. No, they're trying to figure out how to get weight out of that car. And God gives us this illustration. If you're going to run the race that God has for you, you can't do it with a bunch of baggage on you. You can't do it with a bunch of sin or even things that are not necessarily sin, but they weigh you down. There are some good things that will hold you back that you just need to lay aside so that you can run your race. And if you do not do them, you're going to get off the pace. You're going to be a hindrance. Some of you men are a hindrance to your wives. Some of you wives are a hindrance to your husbands. And that doesn't mean you go get your divorce attorney. No! It means take the blue and yellow flag serious, man. Listen to the Holy Spirit and the Word of God and deal with what's holding you back. Well, most people that ignore this flag wind up getting this flag. Oh, whenever this one comes out, now business is starting to pick up. This old black flag, it doesn't mean you have to quit the race. No. It just means you got to go in the pits and deal with your problems. Hello? The race of our life. God says, pull over, man, and repent. Get in the pits, get out of your car, get on your knees, and get right with God. That doesn't mean you quit everything, but it does mean there is a time to step over, go in the pits. In other words, get alone with God and deal with your sin. Because if you don't get out of the way and deal with what is keeping you from running the race, sooner or later the Holy Spirit of God is going to wave the black flag in your life and tell you, you have no option but go to the pits. So when you get this flag, you got to deal with what the problem is. Let us lay aside every weight and sin which does so easily beset us, the King James says, does so easily ensnare us. You've got to run it conscious of how God says to run it. When we got to Brown's Chapel, we had an organ in our church. And the organist would get over there every Sunday morning and she would fire it up and it would go And every Sunday should say, I don't know if it's going to make it. I don't know if it's going to fire up. Well, after a period of time of that happening, quite a while, finally we realized that that organ was actually a fire hazard. And we started talking. We started talking with the leaders and the instrumentalists and saying, listen, why don't we get rid of that organ and get a keyboard and it sounds like an organ? Get the same results, but also be able to do other things, you know, have strings and voices and all that stuff, that angelic sound. Well, when I said that, someone said, yeah, but you know, Miss Maxine Harris, she played the organ for a long time. So I went and I called Miss Maxine. I said, Miss Maxine, the organ. And before I could explain anything, she said, well, preacher, you need to get rid of that thing. You know, Miss Maxine is a good picture of somebody who realized that there was a weight holding down our church, and she was willing to be the one to chunk the weight. She didn't get a black flag. No, she ran her race. Now, let me tell you something. People who get black flags many times get stubborn. Oh, Justin, Ron, they've seen this many times. I've watched it many times. Somebody get a black flag, flagman up there, you know, pointing, you know, grabbing the edge of it, getting real serious, you know. Officials are down there on the inside of the racetrack, and they're pointing at him going, you know, going and getting the spotter, all kind of stuff goes on. But they'll get stubborn and not deal with what the problem is, the reason for the cause of the black flag. And I've seen it over and over and over. There would be drivers that would continue on in their stubbornness, and they would wind up causing a wreck. They would cause somebody to get hurt, and there would be a red flag that would come out, and it would stop the race for everybody. You know, it's amazing in the race that we run as Christians how that if we are not careful in our stubbornness in our race, will affect it for everybody. Just for those who have to have the dots connected, let me grab these two flags again. There is another time when you will see these flags. Most, not always, but a lot of times it's these flags. The flagman will lean over out of the stand and he'll usually tap it and he'll do this number. You know what he's telling them? He's telling them they're, the race is halfway over. You've run half your race. And I show you that before I bring this one out, because this flag right here is the flag they wave when you got one lap left to go. Can I say something? I mean this in love and sincerity. As I look around this auditorium, I see several folks that are way past that halfway mark. And you got your one lap a while ago. Let me ask you a question. Are you running your race? Are you being faithful to God? Now, truth of the matter is, none of us know if we'll live. Brother Dwayne, you and I don't know if we'll make it to Columbia to the convention tomorrow. So I cannot say, hey, well, I'm over there on lap 75 of a 100-lap race. I can't say that. But I do know this. I'm past the halfway mark. My wife and I, we're talking about how we're going into the fourth quarter. We realize that the white flag, the one-lap flag, that one-lap flag has been brought out for us in our life and ministry. And my wife and I, you can pray for us. We want to finish well. We want to complete the race that God has for us. We don't want to cause anybody else to wreck. We don't want to wreck. We don't want to hold anybody back. We want to run the race at the pace that God has for us. We want to get the checkered flag to the glory of God. We don't want anything in our life that would keep us held back from running our race. We've laid aside everything that we know to lay aside. We avoid anything that would keep us from running well. We are running our race, and now we're getting that white flag. Now, what happens when the white flag is waved? Well, those old boys in second and third place, yeah, they're getting ready. Man, they got those straps tight. If they're a good driver, they're thinking, how can I get around this one without wrecking him? If they're a good driver. If they're a bad driver, they'll do anything to get that checkered flag. Now, I'm going to tell you something. Listen to me, those of you that are older. I know of a preacher right here in our county. He got his white flag. And rather than finishing his race well, he hindered the race of other people. His pastor told me, he said, man, I don't know what so-and-so is doing, but he's become a burden in our church rather than a blessing. Finish well. And you know what? I don't need a chalkboard or a PowerPoint to list off ways that you cannot finish well. The Holy Spirit of heaven knows how to apply what we're illustrating in this text. The Holy Spirit is speaking to some of you right now, and He is reminding you that He's not been real pleased with what you've been doing. The Holy Spirit, that flagman from heaven, is saying to you, listen, you better get that right. You need to finish your race well. White flags waved, it really doesn't matter. I don't think a whole lot of how old you are. I believe the Lord will return soon. I don't believe the Lord will return soon because He owes us a favor. I believe the Lord will return soon because of His own name's sake. Well, we're back to that checkered flag. The white flag waves. Guys in second and third place, they're going to try to jockey for, well, even some folks in sixth place, going to try to jockey for the, you know, position to pass the leader on the last lap coming out of turn four. It's a very intense moment for race officials. Sometimes whenever that's going on, you're going, all right, we better get the sheriff over to so-and-so's stall. That is funny, folks. It's not that we have the gift of prophecy and can see who's going to fight. We've just been there before. Amen. There's a lot goes on. But boy, when that checkered flag waves, have you ever noticed something? I guarantee you whenever the NASCAR race finished today, they interviewed second and third place, maybe even fourth. You got this guy doing a burnout, melting his tires. He's got the checkered flag. He's won the race. But they go down in the pits and they interview the guy in second place and third place, and you hear something. Most of the time, not always, but most of the time, they'll say, boy, I tell you what, I'm just thankful for a good race. I'm thankful for my crew. I'm thankful for my sponsors. I'm thankful that I was able to finish. Well, the truth of the matter is, when we get to heaven, God is not going to have a giant checkered flag and say, well, so-and-so, Dwayne, you come on up here. You actually finished better than anybody. No, whenever we get to heaven, the person that will deserve the checkered flag hung on a cross on a hill called Calvary in Jerusalem, he will have the checkered flag, and the rest of us will just be saying, man, we were glad to get to run in this race. We are glad that we brought it home in one piece. We are glad that we were able to finish our race. And we're just such a joy to be here, and we'll be in heaven, and we'll be saying, we sure are thankful for how Jesus brought us home into the winner's circle with Him. We're thankful for Brother Dwayne and Miss Connie. We're thankful and list off preachers and Sunday school teachers and family members that helped us in our race. When we get there, we'll be thankful for all of them. But the one that'll have the checkered flag is Jesus. Yeah, because He's the one that won. And the reason why we can win is He has already won for us. He just says, hey, I've called you into the race. Make sure you run it right. Boy, I tell you what, you want to see a big crowd of cars at a stock car race? Let them advertise that the purse is big bucks. Let them advertise that if you show up, if you pull your car off the hauler and you take the green flag and run one lap, you're guaranteed some good money. And they'll turn out like crazy. Well, God, who designed our race, has told us what the winning prize is. It's not a mansion. It's not being with our family. The winning prize is Jesus. Are you running your race well? That's all you got to worry about. Would you bow your head? As you bow your head, I want you to listen to these words again. Run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. If you're not a Christian, I want to ask you to come and believe on Christ. I want to ask you today to repent and believe. Turn from your sin and trust in Christ and Christ alone, for He is the only one that will get you to heaven. For those of us who say we are Christians, who are you looking at as you run your race? You worried about the driver beside you or behind you or in front of you? Or are you looking to Jesus? You see, there's no way to run it right. You won't lay aside the things that hinder you. You won't lay aside sins. You won't run at the right pace unless you're looking to Jesus. Y'all been praying for revival. Well, if all of us would get our eyes off of everyone and everything that is not or who is not Jesus. If we get our eyes on Jesus, we would have revival. I wonder as the pianist starts to play, if you would, dear sister, I wonder who needs to come and make their way to the altar. Who needs to come and say, you know what? I need my eyes back on Jesus so I can run my race right. Who needs to come and say, you know what? I'm not a Christian, but I need to be saved.